As already announced, Sue said, this takes me right out of my comfort zone. Now, here's the philosophy, and I had to have it explained to me before I really figured it out, but we thought today there'd probably be a few less people show up because it's a long weekend, and then everybody shows up, but that's okay. Now, doesn't the band sound great out here?
Yay.
I think so, and the principal cornets, there's two of them in our band, but you know, we have to play softly, but that sounds great. It sounds great. So thanks for that. And it is a bit of a science experiment. I'm glad to know that we just thought we needed to shake things up just a little bit. So here we are. Feel shaken up this morning. A couple of things to just let you know about off the hop here. Watch your inbox this afternoon. The Winterberry News newsletter will be coming out. You might see some pre-production copies floating around. That's because some folks don't get the email. So you'll see that in your inbox this afternoon. And again, as always, thanks to June. June, I know you're here. It's hard. You're not sitting in the normal places anymore. There's June. Thanks to June, especially for editing and putting that all together. It's been, again, a really good read. Press record. I did that already. So we're recording a little bit this morning just to see how that goes too. Next week, September 11th, and you know that that's a date that when I say it out loud, it just kind of hits September 11th. But next week, September 11th, we're going to celebrate. So we're looking for a better word than Rally Day. I know it's kind of an old word, but we're going to just kind of get everything back together. The service will look, so this is sort of step one of two. The service will look a little different. I think we're going to try and do it outside if we can, if it doesn't rain and stuff. We're just going to try and make some noise out in the neighborhood and make a little bit of that. There's going to be some bouncy castles that might attract some kids over as it did last year. And we've seen some of those kids. I want you to know that we had some folks come last year to our gathering event, and those young ladies especially were coming to our Tuesday night thing. So you know, I know it's a bit of a slow process, but it's a process. And so we're excited to be able to do that. Next Sunday. So plan to be having a worship time that'll be kind of laid back and casual, but then also plan to have a burger or something to eat afterwards. So we're just going to do that next week. So that'll be fun. The other thing, there's a Bible study. There's a few things happening. There's going to be a men's Bible study that happens. And it's going to, as best if I say, watch the newsletter for the topics and stuff. Major Doug's going to be looking after that on Tuesday in the afternoon, same time as every other Tuesday, same time as the ladies group is gathering. There's also a Bible study that's going to happen on starting October the 3rd, which is a very important day on my calendar, October the 3rd. In fact, when I say October the 3rd, my calendar probably lights up. It's on. Is it making noises? October the 3rd is his birthday, so just saying. but there is a sign up on the table on the locking desk for that October 3rd start of a Sunday Bible study soon, right behind. I wanted to just announce to you the passing of Helen Ruins, tragically. But if you'd like, there at this point, and I don't believe there's a funeral arranged, but if you'd like to send a card, please give those to Sue and I, and we'll make sure that the family gets them. Okay, so if you would do that, please. We've sent flowers on behalf of the church to the family and a card. But if you feel like you want to do something, if you knew Helen well, just please feel free to do that. All right, let's try this out. So it's sort of sit down Sunday. You don't have to stand up. I'll try and make sure you're not going to get all stiff in the seats there, but the band's going to help us with the first song. So we're going to kind of follow the order of service. If you need your glasses, get them out. We tried to make this bigger, at least our secretary did, and it just kind of went weird. So let's sing. Psalm 451 is right there. Would you be free from your burden of sin? We're going to sing the first couple of verses. All right. So if you can read from back there now. Just wave your arms wildly. I can't sit either. Here we go. Series of questions that this song asks. Would you be whiter? Yes, whiter than snow. Well, there's no other way to do that than to be washed in the blood of the Lamb when sin's stains are lost and covered in the blood. Let's sing the third verse together. It's not a bad thing to get unplugged every once in a while. And in the old days, song sheets were a pretty common thing, and it was interesting how tricky it was to put that one together, but we did it. And like I said, you get your glasses on and you can see that. And but you'll notice that we're going to sing My Lighthouse. It's a song that we've sung before, but I'm trying not to talk a lot about my big holiday to the Rock, but I'll tell you what, I saw more lighthouses than I've seen in a long time. And it was good. But this song is about the lighthouse. And if you know anything about lighthouses, I had to explain this to my grandson. What the lighthouses do, well, they warn you of rocky shoal. They warn you of things that you need to pay attention to. And so the song reminds us that Jesus is our lighthouse. Mm-hmm. important that I hear you. If you're not sick right now, I can see you. Third verse.
Feel my tomorrow brings with each morning. I rise and sing. God's love will be me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. You are the peace in my troubled sea.
Thank you.
Lord, today as we gather in a slightly different way, pray that you will, in the same way, gather close, drawing close to us. That we will sense the moving of your spirit in our own spirit. And that you'll lift some of those things that we carry, some of the things that weigh us down, some of the things that are deep, deep concerns of ours, some of the family members' needs that are right in front of us. That you'll help us, Lord, even in these moments, to cast off some of those weights, lay them at your feet once again, and follow you closely. Father, as we come to this place, I pray that we'll be able to leave this place having worshiped you and having heard your voice in our hearts. Now watch over us as we worship today. We have brought out some of these songs that we were singing around Easter, and you'll know that that's because we're considering some things in Hebrews chapter 12, which really points our minds and our hearts back to the cross, and causes us to remember that it's not just at Easter time we need to be thinking about the cross. It's not just at Easter time that we need to be thinking about his sacrifice. A couple of these songs really point us in that direction. This one reminds us of Hosanna. Save, we pray, is what Hosanna means.
Let
that it's dangerous for us to get caught up in the tune. But if you believe what you've just sung, God is an amazing, amazing God, our God, who allows the weak, in whatever fashion, spiritually weak, physically weak, emotionally weak, to say, I'm strong. In our struggles, we find our strength in Him. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done. Sing that verse one more time.
Let the weak say, I'm strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done.
Before we look at God's word, there's one more song there, I believe. I believe there's one more song there. Is there one more song there? Thank you for the cross, Lord. Is that on that list?
Thank you.
grab your Bible if you have it, and turn to the 12th chapter of Hebrews. We're doing kind of a end of the summer, beginning of the season, the school season. You know it's the school season, don't you? If you don't have kids going to school, because when you come to church, there's a school bus parked in the parking lot. We actually were contacted by a Christian school this year and asked if they could park a bus at do everything we can, but yeah, you know, it's school time when you see things like that starting to happen. We didn't spend a lot of time in any malls this year, but I know Sue has been buzzing around trying to make sure the kids are all dressed for school and all those kinds of things. So, you know, it's that season, but here at the end of the summer, beginning of the fall, we're taking a bit of time in Hebrews chapter 12. So if you want to, and as I said last week, Probably want to take a few minutes and read chapter 11 sometime. Just a lot of things there for you to help us to understand what chapter 12 is all about. But for this morning, I just want to read a couple verses from chapter 12, repeating from last week. But you know, it's not a bad thing to repeat scripture, is it? In fact, some of my studies this week, I read and troubled me just a little bit that memorization of scripture has kind of gone out the window. It's sad. I've tried not to let that happen in my life, but it has, because we carry so much information with us. And the person writing this was saying that what we do, what we've done, you don't know this, but scientifically, you don't think about this, but scientifically, what you've done by not memorizing stuff and carrying all that information in your pocket, you've freed up your brain to carry other stuff there, I suppose. But we've stopped memorizing things. Do you know your phone number? Okay, well, you can think about that while I read this. Hebrews chapter 12, therefore. And you know how this goes. If it's therefore, we want to figure out what it's there for. Therefore, because of all these people in chapter 11 who have gone on before us in the faith, because of those people and all the legacy that they've left us, therefore, the writer of Hebrews, who could have been Paul, says, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let's just let that sink in and pray. Father, today, we thank you, because we can be here in this place, in this room, worshiping you freely, singing songs of praise without any fear of harm, and that you hear our praises for those places in our world that aren't so free. Lift up our hearts in prayer to you. And thank you for this moment in Jesus' name. Amen. So, to introduce very quickly, last week we kind of talked about life being a race, and we agreed that it probably wouldn't be a good idea that some of us present company for sure would end up in the emergency room if I tried to run home from here. Probably wouldn't go so well. I'd probably be off the side of the road somewhere, like I was the first time that I tried to light up my Raleigh leather-seated 10-speed bicycle in Ottawa. I was a younger man, much younger man. I hadn't conditioned myself, but I thought it'd be a great idea to tune this thing up. It had been carrying it around from place to place to place, and I said, no. I'm going to spend the whole winter putting leather conditioner on that leather seat. And I'm going to make sure it's as soft and supple as it can be, because it had kind of dried out. So I spent a lot of time working on this thing. Had it upside down in my basement, as I recall, in Ottawa. hopped on it first chance I had with the thing all tuned up, fresh brakes, fresh tires, fresh everything, and a nice supple leather seat. They don't make leather seats much anymore. On I went, down the street, under the tunnel, up Moody Hill. If you've been to Ottawa, you'll know Moody Hill. It's a bit of a beast. I got halfway up. I put the bike on the side of the road. I thought for sure I was going to die or have a stroke. I was a much younger man. I hadn't conditioned myself to run that, to ride that little racetrack. I was surprised that nobody stopped. Five or six cars drove by. Nobody stopped to see if I was okay. Here I am, gassed out on the side of the road, just basically hoping I'm going to continue to live. My eyes bugging out of my head. Nobody stopped. Just probably thought, well, there's that crazy Salvation Army guy again. See, life is a race, and we talked about this last week, and if you weren't here with us last week, you can go and take a look at the first verse that I just read to you. But the writer to Hebrews says, let us run the race that is set before us. Now, we set some things before you this morning, didn't we? We set you up to come into this place. Some of you didn't know. Some of you do, because we talked about it Tuesday night, but this is kind of how Tuesday night goes, except there's nobody talking in a microphone. There's no band playing, but we gather in this room, and it's pretty awesome, pretty amazing on Tuesday night. It's just fellowship. It's really all it is. Nothing terribly formal that happens. But we kind of threw you a curveball, and some of you did very well, and some of you, well, you'll go home and say, well, it was Sunday. But, you know, life doesn't give you a lot of warning, does it? Life doesn't give you a lot of warning before it throws you a curveball or a sinker ball if you're a baseball person, before it slaps you in the face if you're not into sports, right? Life is like that. Well, the writer of Hebrews said, and I want you to pay special attention to those words, he said, let us run the race that is set before us. You see, we don't seem to have a whole lot of control sometimes about the race that is set before us and the challenges that we will meet. Hasn't the last couple of years proven that to you? That there are things that happen in our world that we have very little ability to control. And here we are on the other side of that, sort of. So life is a race that is set before us. And we need to run the race with endurance, he said. But we need to make sure that we're not carrying a bunch of stuff that's going to weigh us down or cause us to trip. The weight of life, the snare of sin, was what we talked about last week. So with that picture in your head, I want you to think about the next words that the writer to Hebrews says. I wish I could call him Paul, but there's not enough proof to say that it was Paul, but most likely it was, but he didn't name himself. So we're just going to keep calling him the writer to Hebrews. That's what we're supposed to call him. It says, let us fix our eyes. I believe the King James, the New King James that I read to you says, looking unto. But I like the New International for this. It says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Now, I'm not going to be so naive as to say to you, well, okay, folks, there's the sermon. You go home, fix your eyes on Jesus, all shall be well. It's not easy, is it, to fix your eyes on Jesus? When he says this, when he says, fix your eyes on Jesus, what he's talking about is you straining to focus something that's in the distance. The idea is it's not something that's right there in front of you that you can see very easily. It's something that you're going to have to strain a little bit. I've noticed that the older I get, the more straining I'm doing. And, you know, sometimes I just get in and put the glasses on. But I'm telling you that what he's trying to say to us is that to fix your eyes on Jesus is to bring him into focus. Bring him into focus. Now, there are a lot of problems to that, and we're not going to go through all of them. But all I have to do is turn back one page or so in my book here and remind you of some of the things that we called hindrances to the faith last week. I'll read the list real quick, and it might bring some things to memory. Chaos and confusion. Remember, that can hinder your faith. And it's common. It's common in our world. chaos and confusion? How about depression and despair? Things that just weigh us down until we can't bear up under it. And that is life, and that is hard. How about isolation and loneliness, worry and anxiety, bitterness and anger, and compounded problems that overwhelm? If you want the list, shoot me a note, I'll send it to you. I'm just saying to you that there are things that are natural to this world that we live in that weigh us down and cause us to feel like we're carrying a bag of rocks on our back as we walk this walk of faith. So we can look at the hindrances, but let's think about some other things. I wrote down this, what distracts us from our faith? I wrote down shiny things. You know what I'm saying? It's like anything, but it's like squirrel. We're so distracted. The other thing that I wrote down was screens. And then I wrote down screens. And then I wrote down screens. Isn't it something? Have you thought about it? Everywhere you go, there are screens. There's one right in front of us right there. I'm using it to record this morning. I've got a screen in my car. I'm not supposed to look at it too much, but I've got a screen in my car that picks up the screen in my phone and puts the screen in the phone in the car so that I can drive and know where I'm going. We get screens everywhere, screens on your desk. My son and daughter-in-law, sons and daughters-in-law, are doing everything they can to limit screens in their young people's lives. But I'm just saying to you, everywhere we go, it's screens. Do you read the newspaper, that smelly, inky thing anymore? If you do, you're in the minority. Most of us get our news on the screen. And I'll tell you this, and I'm not trying to suck up to anybody who used to be in the print business. I love reading the newspaper. It just does something for me to sit there. I'll sit down and read the flyer that comes in the mail. I don't know, I'm weird. But we don't read that way anymore. It's screens, it's quick information, it's instant information, it's information that we have at our disposal all the time. I want to say to you that takes your focus off some of the things you should be focused on. Shiny things. So I'm saying, put your focus, fix your eyes on Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. It's a tough sell, isn't it? Imagine being a preacher these days. I'm expecting you to sit there or stand and listen to me talk for 20 to 30 minutes. No comments. I'll give you the $5 later. 20 to 30 minutes every Sunday and listen to me talk about Jesus in a world that's filled with animation. I said we don't read the newspaper. No, we get news feeds. Watch videos. We go to YouTube. We go to Twitter. We go to places where we can get some action into the thing. And I'm asking you to listen to me talk about Jesus for a half hour a week. It's a tall order. I give you great credit if you can do it. I'll do my best to make it as interesting as possible, but it's not easy. Because it's not the world we live in anymore. But here's what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to make Jesus the center of your life. That's what the writer to Hebrews said. Fix your eyes on Jesus. I'm asking you to put him at the center of your life, whatever that means. And I'm going to give you 5 ways to do it real quick. And you can look these up if you want. You can fact check this if you look up the Navigator's Wheel. It's been with me since I was a kid, I think. Well, since I was 20 anyway. I want you to think about putting Jesus at the center of your life by spending time in his word. When I look at the wheel, it's got 4 spokes. We'll preach on this maybe later on in the year. But I want you to put aside some time to be in the word. And the spoke on that part of the wheel goes down, right? Ground you in the word. And then I want you to spend some time in prayer. How do you fix your eyes on Jesus? You spend some time in the word. You spend some time in prayer. How else? I said there'd be 5. Well, here's number 3, I think, or 4. 3. The other side would be spend some time in fellowship, just like this. Be with fellow Christians. Be with them. Not just be with them. Be with them. right? Get into it with them. Talk about your faith with fellow Christians. The fourth spoke is witnessing. Talk to other people about your faith. So the word, prayer, fellowship, witnessing, and be obedient to Christ. It's the outside of the way. It's not flashy and it's not shiny, is it? But that's it. How do you fix your eyes on Jesus? You spend time in the word. You spend time in prayer. You spend time in fellowship. You spend some time witnessing about your faith. And you seek everything you can to make Christ the center of your life and be obedient to him. So let's talk about your faith just for a minute. Not for very long. The word, the writer of the Hebrews says, fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. I pointed your attention this morning to the newsletter. It's going to be in your inbox this afternoon. And some of you got the early copies and paper copy. If you know somebody that wants that, please let me know. We'll get them on the list to get it. And June and Doug look after a lot of that stuff, making sure we're up to date on that list. But let me tell you that I only write one thing in that newsletter. It's the front page. I'm honored to do it. But I want to tell you, and this time was no different than any time that I've had the privilege to write that. It starts out way too long, like most of my sermons. And then I trim it down, trim it down, trim it down. And I want you to think about that when you think about your faith. Jesus is the author of your faith. He authored your faith. And he is the perfecter or the editor of your faith. So what we've said just a few minutes ago, that life is a race, and it causes us to have to take some interesting turns in that process. And Jesus, the author of your faith, and the finisher, the editor, if you will, of your faith, will use every single situation, no matter how great a situation, no matter how difficult a situation, he will use every single situation to develop your faith, to develop your faith. Jesus is the author and the perfecter or the editor of your faith. So if you're writing notes, your focus is on Jesus. Your faith is in his hands. Allow him to take hold of it. What was his focus? It's interesting that the writer takes us there. It says that look to Jesus. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him, the race is set before you. You got a race to run. It's not going to be easy every day. Sometimes it's going to be uphill. We've talked about this. The race is set before you. The Bible says the joy that was set before him was the cross. It's hard to say the word joy and cross in the same sentence. It shouldn't be easy. There is no joy in a cross. There is no joy in what happened to Jesus. There is no joy in what took place, except that he had his eyes on the prize, which was your redemption. So he went to the cross to be the atoning sacrifice for your sins and my sins. There was a purpose. And the joy that was deep down inside of him was the cross, horrible, horrific as it was, the result of it was that you could say to him, God, forgive my sins. Make me your child. Allow me to be in your family. The joy that was set before him was the cross. In that truth, the race that is set before you is a life of faith. I looked for a better word than the last word that I wrote down for the last part of this little passage. The best thing I could come up with was his function. So his focus, your faith. His focus was the cross. What is his function? Seems like kind of a cold word, but when I thought about it a little more, yeah, it works. What is his function? Well, have a look at it. In the second verse, the last line, it says, after he had endured the cross, despising the shame, he has sat down at the right hand of of the throne of God. Now, if you were to flip back to Romans 8:34, you can do that later, but it reminds us that what is he doing sitting there at the right hand of God? Is it just a holiday for him that he got out of the world, it was a tough place, now he's back in heaven, chilling, drinking nice tea at the right hand of God? No. He intercedes for you. He intercedes for you. I don't know if you've ever had somebody intercede for you. Actually, I'm sure you have. Because I have for you. So go through the church directory. I'll intercede. Sue will intercede for you. We feel it's part of our role. You may not have told us of any need you've got. You might have been very careful to protect us from knowing those needs. Still going to pray for you. We don't care. We're going to intercede for you. We're going to pray that God will do what God needs to do in your life to deepen you in the faith. That's what we're going to do. But if you've ever been directly interceded for, that somebody has actually taken your situation and prayed for your situation, with all of the knowledge that you have given to them about your situation, that's Jesus' role, and there are no secrets with him. He knows exactly where you are. He knows exactly what's going on. He knows precisely the need that you have right now, today, in this moment, in this breath. The Bible says, he sits at the right hand of the throne of God, interceding for you. Jesus, his function in heaven, not just to sip iced tea and relax. That was a tough one, that earth thing, but it's over now. No. He intercedes for your needs. That is miraculous for me to think about. How in the world? Well, there's no way in the world. Only in heaven. Jesus on the throne, crowned with many crowns, reigning victorious, interceding for you. The race, yes, we don't know exactly what the next turn is, but the faith happens when we fix our eyes on him, who is the author and the editor, author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame of the cross, died, rose again, sits at the right hand of the Father, praying for you. Let's pray. Jesus, we come in the midst of the race. For some of us today, as we gather in this place, it's a downhill journey. Things are going pretty well. We've got our winds at our back. Things are going great. For some of us, not so much. For some of us in this room, Lord, the things that we endure are tough every day. For some, the things that we're going through right now are rather bland, perhaps. It's a mixed thing. Think about the week I had last week, going from a funeral to a wedding. Life's kind of like that, but you are with us. Every step, every breath, deepening our faith. Lord, our commitment to you today, afresh, would be to refocus on your word, to refocus on prayer, to make fellowship the priority, to talk about our faith and make you the center of our life in obedience to you. Lord, I pray that will be our hearts and in the days forward, because we need every hour. Thank you. A song that's close to the end of your song sheet there. Lord, I come. I confess. Out here I find my rest. Without you, fall apart. For the one guard guides and guards my heart. Lord, I need you. Every hour I need you. Thank you. We've got one song that the band is going to help us play. It's got an amazing chorus and a verse that tells a story like all of our songs do. So go to the back page. See it there. My heart is full of music and gladness as on wings of love and faith I upward fly. Not a shadow cloud, my Savior's face obscuring, climbing up to my homestead in the sky. An oldie, a beauty. Let's give it a whirl together.
Thank you.
these words, it certainly speaks of the grace of faith that we are in. Oh, the joy of getting others to climb with me, witnessing, a very important part of your walk of faith. Lost, despairing, brokenhearted, may all come. Calvary love has made the stair very wide. Sinners lay your burden down and hasten home. Let's sing this together in the third verse. Fellowship in the foyer, a little more relaxed. I know I still put my tie on, but still a little more relaxed. And we're going to close the service with our sung benediction. And please sing that. Wash this over all of us. So, Father, O Son, O Spirit, triune God, praise be to thee. Sing it together. Thank you.